introduction. I am very happy to visit your campus once again. I doubt that very many of you were here the last time I had the opportunity to speak. I see a few hands. I had the opportunity to meet President Ann Hewitt shortly before. And I'd also like to thank all of the sponsors and, of course, Dr. Mary Myers, with whom I had the opportunity to spend a few hours yesterday and today. I understand that here in the state of New Hampshire, you will be engaging in serious discussions about racism and mass incarceration this semester, and that there will be, if I'm correct, a statewide teach-in at the end of October on this topic. And I think I was originally asked to come around the time of the teach-in, but was unable because of my schedule. So I actually think it's a good thing that I'm coming early, because that means that you will have an entire month to reflect on various issues related to race and incarceration. I learned that the title of my talk is The Meaning of Freedom. I just learned that. Which is the title of a book that I recently published. My remarks are actually going to revolve around the current debates around mass incarceration. And of course, that inevitably requires us to deeply reflect on the question of freedom. Many people have asked me whether I am excited about the fact that finally, after decades of failure to acknowledge the prison crisis, suddenly it seems everyone is turning their attention in the direction of mass incarceration. And I make this observation as a person who has been directly involved in justice campaigns related to prisons for the overwhelming majority of my life. I always reflect on the fact that had someone told me 40 years ago, 50 years ago, that this would be the trajectory of my life, it would have seemed quite surprising. But speaking about historical trajectories, or my own historical trajectory, let me make an observation about the extent to which historical perspective allows us to forge richer understandings of whatever we're trying to comprehend. In order to develop a deeper comprehension of what is often called the crisis of mass incarceration, we can't simply begin with current events. We can't simply start with the present. If you focus primarily on the present, you will acquire the mistaken impression that what is shaped purely by immediate circumstances or what happened not very long ago. And that perhaps what happened in the past is securely locked away from the present. And so I want to begin with a quotation from an essay that was written in the 1980s by critical theorist Frederick Jameson, who wrote in an essay called Postmodernism and Consumer Society. He wrote about what he called the disappearance of a sense of history. And I'm quoting from his essay, "The way in which our entire contemporary social system has little by little begun to lose its capacity to retain its own past, to retain its own past, has begun to live in a perpetual present that obliterates traditions of the kind which all earlier social formations have had in one way or another to preserve. Think only about the media exhaustion of news, of how Nixon, and even more so Kennedy, are figures from a now distant past. He was writing this in the 1980s, I should say. One is tempted to say that the very function of the news media is to relegate such recent historical experiences as rapidly as possible into the past. The informational function of the media would thus be to help us forget, to serve as the very agents and mechanisms for our historical amnesia. And so, I would say that in order to grasp the complex connections between racism and over-incarceration, we have to acknowledge the deep historical roots of racism, of punishment, and their inextricable interactions. And this would mean, for example, that we cannot simply focus on the war on drugs as the driving force for mass incarceration. And this has been, of course, one of the explanations that has been preferred, especially recently. The war on drugs was certainly one of the factors, especially with respect to federal institutions, federal facilities, but even more important was the attack on the welfare state that helped to usher in the era of global capitalism. During the 1980s, and of course that is the period when the numbers of incarcerated people began to soar. During the 1980s, we witnessed the beginning of the breakdown of institutions that were designed to ensure human welfare, such as the healthcare system, housing, education. And at the same time, jobs began to migrate to areas of the world where labor was cheaper and the labor movement was less organized. It is not accidental that the numbers of union members have declined as the numbers of imprisoned people have risen. 50 years ago, 1/3 of all workers were unionized. Today, it is only 1 in 10. And of course, Black people and people of color were most seriously affected by this downspin in union membership, as we can see today by the racial composition of low-wage jobs, the racial composition of the unemployed and the racial composition of low-wage jobs, and the current effort to achieve a $15 minimum wage. And that is, that's quite astounding, isn't it? That we can't even take for granted a living wage. Now, I mentioned these economic developments because one has to ask, what is it that has been responsible for people engaging in underground activity that might lead along a trajectory toward arrest and imprisonment? And I say parenthetically, we know, we follow the stop and frisk movement, and we know that people who are caught in that web of repression, police, prisons, have not necessarily engaged in, quote, illegal activity. But of course, people do engage in unlawful activity. a lot of people engage in a lot of activity. Many, many more people than are actually targeted. And I think it's important for us to recognize the role of surveillance. That is one of the factors related to structural racism that leads to higher numbers of people of color being caught up in the web of the criminal justice system. But if drugs are a factor, then we have to ask why the turn towards drugs and drug trafficking. Now, I may try to address that later. But right now I want to talk about deindustrialization, the deindustrialization process during the 1980s, beginning in the 1980s, that resulted in the exportation of entire industries to areas of the world where corporations could find cheaper labor. Because I mention this because this process had a devastating impact on black people, on Latinos, on other communities of color, and poor people in general. And at the same time, I'm trying to complicate the picture, provide some kind of historical perspective, so that we don't assume that the solutions are solutions to immediate problems, but rather these issues have a long and very deep history. And so I would say also that the flip side of deindustrialization, the flip side of the exportation of jobs and entire industries to countries where the labor movement was not as strong, countries where the corporate forces could find cheaper labor, the flip side was immigration. And I don't think in our discussions about racism and over-incarceration, we include the large question of immigration, which is, as many people have pointed out, the civil rights issue of the 21st century, not only in the US, but as we know, all over the world. But as jobs became unavailable in industries like steel and auto and manufacturing in general, at the same time, there was this concerted assault on the social services people would have required in order to avoid succumbing to these conditions. Black women were especially targeted during this era as welfare queens. The targeting of black women as welfare queens becomes an ideological preface to the dismantling of welfare. Let's remember that in 1970, there were 200,000 people in prison. Now everybody knows there are 2.2 million people. And I've said many times, I was in jail in 1970, by the way. I was one of those 200,000 people. And when we began to look at the role of the prison apparatus in preserving and expanding racism and repression, it appeared from that vantage point that there were far too many people behind bars. So as we say today, there are 2.2 million people behind bars. We said then there are 200,000 people in jails and prisons, which is incidentally about the number of people who are incarcerated in India, with a population of almost 3 billion. So as well-paying jobs began to decline, as social services such as welfare, healthcare, education began to decline, underground economies began to flourish. They began to flourish precisely in the vacuum created by these developments. So it is no accident that the rise of the illicit drug trade, incidentally, is accompanied by the increased profitability of the pharmaceutical industry. This is a comparison, unfortunately, I don't have time to pursue, but what I would like you to think about here is the role of capitalist profit. In many ways, the so-called war on drugs is in defense of a rising pharmaceutical industry, and at the same time, a rising pharmaceutical industry that relies on offering the message that every problem one can experience can be solved by drugs, which has its impact on the illicit drug industry. But let me see if I can, I've already been speaking 17 minutes and I haven't gotten to the main point that I wanted to. So if you've been following the news, you will have read numerous articles recently about mass incarceration.